Welcome to Backstage with Portland Choir and Orchestra. This is our podcast series where we pull back the curtain on some of our performances and take a closer look at the music, its background, its meaning, and why we thought our audiences would like it. Today's theme, Christmas songs that inspire us to be better. I'm joined by Dr. David Thomas, Artistic Director of Portland Choir and Orchestra. Hello, David.
Hi, Brad. It's nice to be with you again.
Great. And I am your host, Brad Goodwin. Each episode, we choose music on a theme and look back through our archives to find examples from our performances that correspond to that theme. Today's theme is Christmas songs that inspire us to be better. And we have four musical selections that we're going to share with you. First, The Work of Christmas, lyrics by Howard Thurman, music by Dan Forrest. Grown Up Christmas List, lyrics by Linda Thompson Jenner, music by David Foster, arrangement David Clydesdale. The Secret of Christmas, lyrics by Sammy Kahn, music by Jimmy Van Heusen, arranged by Ronald Staley. And Put Memory Away, lyrics by Elizabeth Jennings, music by Bob Chilcott. Before we get started talking about and listening to the Christmas songs, let's just talk just briefly about our plans for the 2020 Christmas season. Portland Choir and Orchestra has performed a Christmas concert every year since our inception in 2005. But due to the effects of the COVID-19 pandemic, unfortunately, we will not be performing live this Christmas. And instead, we're going to flood the zone, and by that I mean flood our YouTube channel, with Christmas music from our archives all through the Christmas season. We have three Christmas episodes of this podcast planned, including this, the first one. Plus, watch for the YouTube premiere of our Christmas concert entitled Gloria, coming up a week from today, Saturday, December 5th. I know it's not the same as going downtown and attending a live performance at a beautiful theater in Portland, and we would by far prefer to perform live for you this year, but events have conspired against us, and for the safety of our musicians and for our audience, we will not perform live this Christmas season. Our hope is that we can be back on stage in June to perform Ellis Island, The Dream of America, which is going to be a fantastic concert. But we'll have to evaluate conditions as the date approaches. So please watch our website for details, musicinportland.org. So let's get started with today's episode, Christmas songs that inspire us to be better. All of these songs ask us to look inside our own hearts and ask, am I bringing the promise of Christmas into my life? Am I the best person I can be? Not just at Christmas time, but all year round. David, let's start with The Work of Christmas.
Thank you, Brad. You know, The Work of Christmas, it's a modern setting musically. It was written in 2014 by Dan Forrest. The text is a little older. It's a poem by Howard Thurman, and it was published in 1973. Dan Forrest ran across the poem in January 2014 and was bowled over by it. In the preface to the sheet music, there's a quote that he includes where he says that some texts are best left alone as poetry. Once in a while, though, a text seems to sing right off the page, and this poem did just that.
Well, the poet, Howard Thurman, was an author, a philosopher, a religious leader, a civil rights leader, who lived from, I guess his career was really from 1926 up to his death in 1974. He wrote a bunch of books on religious history, philosophy, and poetry. And indeed, it was in his 1973 book, The Mood of Christmas, that had the short poem, Now the Work of Christmas Begins, which forms the text of this musical number. David, so how did you come across this piece? What appealed to you about it? And why did you make it part of our Christmas concert?
You know, I try to stay up to date on all of Dan Forrest's compositions and arrangements. And as soon as this one came up as being released soon, I got an early copy of it and immediately fell in love with it. What appealed to me, Brad, was the text. And I also love the music because it doesn't get in the way of the text. Rather, it acts as a vehicle to experience the powerful message that Howard Thurman has provided for us. And when I'm programming our annual Christmas celebration concerts, I love having at least one piece. I love it if we have more than one, but if we can just have one piece that leaves a meaningful, lasting impression on the listener, that's what I'm looking for. Because it also means that as performers, we've had a significant experience ourselves. We interact with that composition for weeks or months ahead of time, and it truly has an impact on our lives as the performers, which makes the concert experience that much more special for all of us.
Well, what is it about the text or the message of this one that you think really inspires people to be better humans all year long?
For me, I think the genius of Thurman's writing comes from his juxtaposition of the stopping of actions in the first half compared with the simple but powerful action words in the second half of the poem. There are plenty of songs that talk about how Christmas can be a difficult time for some people, or other songs remind us how we should remember Christmas all year through. And still other Christmas songs talk of the melancholy post-Christmas moods that we might experience. Thurman, he not only addresses each of those ideas, but he does it in a clear, elegant, but still motivational way, directing us to action. So we don't just remember Christmas or think about it more or miss it. We actually make the magic and the music of Christmas by the lives that we lead after the traditional parts of Christmas are through. And I think that it is inspirational. When people hear it, especially with Dan Forest's beautiful music, you can't help but just think, I really want to do those things that Thurman talks about in his poem.
Great. Well, let's listen now to The Work of Christmas, performed by Portland Choir and Orchestra at our Christmas concert in December 2016.
When the king
Next is Grown Up Christmas List. Of the four songs we're presenting today, this is probably the most familiar to our listeners. It's been a pop standard ever since Amy Grant recorded it for her Christmas album in 1993. Since then, it's been recorded by many artists. Kelly Clarkson had a well-known recording in 2001 that spent about 5 weeks on the Billboard Adult Contemporary chart. The composer David Foster, he's one of the most prolific modern pop composers. He's composed or produced hit songs by Barbara Streisand, Rod Stewart, Christina Aguilera, Mariah Carey, Michael Bublé, and many more. Have you ever heard of The Prayer with Celine Dion and Andrea Bocelli, written by David Foster? Remember the rock group Chicago's Hard to Say I'm Sorry or You're the Inspiration? Also Foster hits. Whitney Houston's I Have Nothing from The Bodyguard, also by Foster. He's become sort of a go-to producer for Christmas albums. He's produced the best-selling Christmas albums for Kenny Rogers and Dolly Parton, for Amy Grant, Celine Dion, Josh Groban, Andrea Bocelli, Michael Bublé, Jordan Smith, and others. Four of these albums, they rank among the top 15 best-selling Christmas albums ever. Wow.
And let's talk a minute about the lyricist, Linda Thompson Jenner, who is every bit as accomplished as David Foster. In fact, she was married to him at the time that they wrote Grown Up Christmas List. She began songwriting in 1985 and wrote songs for Kenny Rogers, Josh Groban, Celine Dion, the Backstreet Boys, and others, and collaborated with her then husband, David Foster, on this song, as well as I Have Nothing by Whitney Houston from The Bodyguard and the 1996 Olympic theme song. David, what is it that attracted you to this piece? Why did we sing Grown Up Christmas List?
Mostly, it was to feature some of our beautiful solo voices that we have in the choir. I thought this would be a nice feature opportunity.
What do the lyrics mean to you?
I think a key message of the lyrics is found in a very small section. It's the bridge in the song, musically, and it says, "What is this illusion called the innocence of youth? Maybe only in our blind belief can we ever find the truth." So most of the song appears to be this kind of growing up, coming of age, I'm moving from toys and presents to these complex ideas like world peace, and it's maybe even sort of smacks of a rejection of these childhood Christmas lists. But I think that this line ties it all together and is trying to tell us, at least subtly, that we should always keep with us just a piece of that childhood goodness, of the purity and the hope that we have as children, even or especially as we mature out of our childhood dreams and desires. And that can help us really find our way in adulthood. And now let's listen to Portland Choir and Orchestra perform Grown Up Christmas List from our December 2016 concert, featuring longtime choir member Kristen Gardner as soloist.
Wars will never stop.
third of our four songs today is a relatively little-known Christmas song, The Secret of Christmas. It's actually from a 1959 Bing Crosby movie called Say One for Me. And, you know, it's a classic sort of Hollywood musical of the 40s and 50s. Bing Crosby plays a parish priest on Broadway, you know, at Christmas time. You know, it's the perfect setup.
Yeah, it's one of about 100 songs that the award-winning songwriting duo Jimmy Van Heusen and Sammy Kahn wrote together over the years. Their work spanned movies, television, Broadway. As a team, they won 3 Academy Awards for Best Original Song. And Sammy Kahn and Jimmy Van Heusen were especially associated closely with Frank Sinatra. They wrote over 75 songs just for him, some of which became Sinatra's biggest hits. The Look of Love, The Tender Trap, Come Fly With Me, High Hopes, songs like these.
I want to talk just a bit about the arranger of this piece, Ronald Staley, a widely respected choral composer, arranger, conductor, and teacher. He was professor of music at Brigham Young University for 37 years and just retired back in 2015. Over the years, Portland Choir and Orchestra has performed several Ron Staley arrangements. Now, since we both know Ron, and you much better than me, I want to spend just a few more minutes than maybe we usually would to talk about him. As I said, you know him much better than I did, but allow me just to mention my tenuous connection. I entered BYU as a freshman in 1979, which is 1 year after Dr. Staley started as a professor there. I was the drum major of the marching band, so I spent a lot of time hanging out in the Harris Fine Arts Center and had interactions with many of the music professors, including Ron. I'm not sure exactly how I came to know him, but I did. And, you know, we would exchange pleasantries if we bumped into each other in the hallways. I'll never forget, never, a specific concert where Dr. Staley conducted the BYU Oratorio Choir my freshman year in 1979. I think I had a professor, Clayne Robison, who was a soloist in the oratorio, and I'm pretty sure that's how I came to learn about it. It was the premiere of a newly written oratorio with full choir, orchestra, and soloists, the very kind of music that Portland Choir and Orchestra performs. I'd never heard an oratorio before. I hadn't even heard of oratorios before, and I'd never experienced anything like it. The stage must have had 200 musicians on it. It was a complete assault on my senses, and it was deeply moving to me. I still remember it to this day. I was so taken by the performance that I purchased an audio cassette of it and listened to it for years until the coating literally disintegrated from the tape. So that's my story. You were a lot closer to him than I was. Just tell us a bit about your association with Dr. Staley.
My first experience with Dr. Staley was similar to yours. As a freshman at BYU, he conducted a combined choir and orchestra and soloist performance of an oratorio, Robert Kundick's Redeemer. I was singing under Mac Wilberg in BYU Concert Choir at the time, and I thought to myself after one rehearsal, wow, I knew we had one masterful choral musician here, but it appears we have two. One of the first things I learned in that oratorio experience was that I was learning as much about challenging myself in an emotional and a spiritual way as I was learning about pushing myself musically. And it's that kind of whole person integrity and mentality within the performance experience that permeated the next 5 years of my study with him. As a member of BYU Singers, I sang for 5 years and then studied with him for 2 years. He was my faculty mentor when I was in the graduate degree program there in choral conducting.
What about his influences on you? I mean, personal or musical or any other influences?
I credit Ron Staley with having the greatest total impact on me as a musician outside of my mother, who gave me an entire childhood and many adult years of incredible musical experiences. But in just 5 years of study with Dr. Staley, I acquired the kind of deep knowledge and experience that not only stay with a person for a lifetime, but in my experience, they actually require a lifetime to unpack and apply in real life. The list of specifics that I'm talking about goes on. It's long, it's meaningful. My love for round, unified tone, whole-bodied commitment to singing and producing the sound, impeccable diction, attention to detail in your preparation, score study. As a singer or a conductor, either one, diligent attention to healthy singing and the conducting gesture that inspires healthy singing and elicits a beautiful tone. And there's so many more. I remember hearing him often encouraging us as singers, don't have superficial relationships with each other. Get past the fluff and really get to know each other. And that's how he lives his life. He's committed. And he chooses what he wants to be involved with and lives it to the fullest.
Yeah, you know, in preparing for our discussion today, I Googled his name, and I discovered that a doctoral student did his dissertation on Ron Staley's style and his musical influence. It was 300 plus pages long, and it actually... It was fascinating as I read through it. And many of the things you've just described about how he took and made rehearsal and the performance of the words and notes a very personal and spiritual activity really shined through in that dissertation that I read as well. What do you do in performance, or for that matter in rehearsal, that came from Ron Staley?
Some things that come to mind, Brad, that I try to do are prepare for the rehearsal in a way that is meaningful, not just for the singers, but for me. My experiences with Dr. Staley taught me that there is not a second of rehearsal time that you will ever be glad you wasted. It needs to be spent wisely. And so becoming a rehearsal technician, singers, I believe, really love that, because all of a sudden they realize that that's an extremely valuable time that we have together, and so they approach it as something of high value. And that's on a very fundamental level something that I try to bring to the rehearsal. He loves to have planned out his vocal exercises and warm-ups in the beginning of the rehearsal so that they influence the rest of the rehearsal. He'll often have musical snippets that are the vocal exercises themselves from pieces we'll be rehearsing later on. And so in a 90-minute rehearsal, you'll be 75 minutes through and you'll be thinking, wow, I'm singing this really well. How did I do that? And you realize it's because he taught you how to do it in a 2.5-minute warm-up exercise 70 minutes earlier. It's that kind of detailed planning and preparation that can really, really build a strong and unified choir. I love the focus on the conducting gesture. And this has been something that I've tried to emulate, honestly, because he does it so well. The synchronization of his heart and his mind and his hands and his face he is a real master. It's something that over his lifetime, he has just become stronger and better at doing. And it shows. His singers reflect that in their unity of tone, in the expression that they give. One of his quotes that has stuck with me over the years is that our job as a choir is to express, not impress. And you hear that and feel that and see that when he conducts. He's not getting in the way. He's allowing the audience and the choir to just connect. And that's something that I try to bring when we have a concert, is to not get in the way, but to facilitate that relationship and connection between the audience and the choir members.
Yeah, I have seen that in his conducting as well. He is not a flashy conductor, but when you hear what comes out of the choir, you know that they have been rehearsed like nothing else in the world. You know, folks, if you have not heard the BYU Singers, I encourage you to listen to them. If you have Apple Music or Spotify or something like that, just search for BYU Singers. And in fact, you can listen to anything that they've done, but I would steer you personally towards their collaboration with Eric Whitaker, where they did two albums of his work. And it's some of the most beautiful, complex, but expressive music that I've ever heard. And I think that really, for me, encapsulates what you're describing about him.
I want to just jump back in here and say one more thing in response to what you've said just now. When you, the fusion of his physical gesture and then the sound that you hear from the choir, it's so good that I think that a lot of people don't understand exactly what's happening. But when you say it sounds like the choir has really rehearsed this, you're right. But he is taking risks and changing things every time that piece is performed, whatever piece it is. And sometimes in a semester or a year at BYU, you will have sung a piece 15 times or 20 times or 30 times by the end of the year, and especially if you go on a tour. But because he has such control over his physical gesture, he does not make a motion that should not be attended to. And so you know as a singer that if he does something, he's communicating something to you. And it creates a powerful palette of colors and tones and sounds. And with the slightest change of his hand or his wrist or his fingers or his face even, he can ask you to do things and you respond as a singer instantaneously. And it appears that it's all very rehearsed and programmed, but it's actually quite spontaneous and happening in the moment. And even on the recordings that you just encouraged listeners to go find and enjoy, that's happening in the recording sessions as well. It's a pretty amazing experience.
To turn this into a shameless plug, because it is not intended in that way, but if you do listen to the BYU Singers and their recordings of Eric Whitaker, just know that one of those beautiful baritone voices in the recording is none other than David Thomas.
That's right. Yeah, those years hold a very dear place in my heart. We worked closely with Eric Whitaker. He is an incredible person in his own right, and we could have a whole podcast just about the things that we learned from him and his music, but that was a very special experience to work with him and record and premiere his piece when David heard that Absalom was slain, a masterful work of his.
Now, about 6 years ago, about a year before Dr. Staley's retirement, the BYU Singers came to town. They came to Portland, and PCO, Portland Choir and Orchestra, was pleased to sponsor them in their concert here. Tell us a little bit about your experience of bringing your old mentor back into town.
This was a particularly special experience for us, as you well remember, Brad, and as our audience can imagine. We were able to secure one of the most fitting venues for the Ron Staley and BYU Singers choral sound, that signature round tone, beautifully placed in St. Mary's Cathedral in downtown Portland. We held a joint workshop together earlier that day at PSU, definitely a highlight for us, and then we enjoyed that sold-out performance at the cathedral. We were really grateful to be able to have this experience in the penultimate year of Dr. Staley's career.
Well, one of Dr. Staley's student assistants back in the day was none other than Mac Wilberg, who went on to become a BYU music professor himself and now conducts the Tabernacle Choir at Temple Square. Now, as you mentioned, you've had interactions with both of them, and they've both had a big impact on you. I was interested to learn that they share more than you in common. They both got their undergraduate degrees at BYU, focused on piano, and then they both independently went to the University of Southern California for their master's and doctorate degrees. Neither of them focused on choral conducting until they started their graduate studies. And then upon graduation, they both returned to BYU as music professors, Mac conducting the men's chorus and the concert choir, and Ron conducting the BYU Singers. Well, when we started out, we didn't intend for this to be quite as big of a retrospective of Ron Staley's career, but it has been fun to reminisce about his influences on us, both personally and professionally. And I think that those influences bleed through into everything that Portland Choir and Orchestra does because of your, leadership of the choir as the artistic director. So with that, let's listen now to Portland Choir and Orchestra performing Staley's arrangement of The Secret of Christmas from our December 2012 Christmas concert.
It's not a Christmas call.
Let's continue with our next Christmas song that inspires us to be better, Put Memory Away. This is another modern piece. It was written less than 20 years ago in 2004 by Bob Chilcott. Now, you may not recognize the name, but you'll definitely recognize his alma mater. Chilcott was a member of the famous British a cappella group, the King's Singers, and arranged many of their iconic songs. You're listening to his arrangement of The Gift, a song that's been on my Christmas playlist for many years. This song, Put Memory Away, began as the fourth movement in a Christmas cantata that he was writing, but it also stands alone as a very thoughtful Christmas carol. I can almost guarantee you've never heard it before. No pop star or major orchestra has yet put it on their Christmas album, and as far as I can tell, there are only two live performances of it posted on YouTube, ours being one of them. But it is beautiful, and it will grow on you.
I agree, Brad. It's based on a poem by British poet Elizabeth Jennings entitled Carol for 2000. The poem consists of five verses, each of which begins with an injunction, put memory away.
And what attracted you to this piece? How did you come to know about it?
I had never heard of this piece, although I am a fan of Bob Chilcott, who set the poem to this musical composition. It also caught my attention because I didn't quite understand it. And it was an interesting text. And I'm always curious about a Christmas song that maybe I don't quite get at first. So I was interested to know what is the song about, but I loved it. It has the ability, this text does, to speak differently to different people, as is often the case with good poetry. And for me, I think that the song inspires different people in different ways, but for me, it's a very, I can boil it down to one simple idea, that it's easy to get lost in our memories when we really ought to be paying attention to the things that are going on around us and the good things that are happening.
I had a similar reaction. I was really struck by the moody, thoughtful, almost pensive musical arrangement. I loved it, but I just really didn't understand that repeated phrase, put memory away. It didn't seem Christmassy to me, but I think I get it now. Jennings is reminding us that at Christmas time, we're naturally inclined to entwine our enjoyment of the season with memories of the past. You know, fond memories of Christmases growing up, Christmases with family and friends, shared presents, and all that kind of stuff, like you said. But when we think about Christ, the Christ in Christmas, the story of Christ is a story of hope, and hope looks forward, not backward. So to put memory away is to not ignore or shut out the past, but instead to turn our heart and our mind to the future, to bring hope to our lives, to see our lives as redeemable. You know, in the text, as you'll see, bells ring out to bring in a new year. A child puts out a stocking in anticipation of the future. And indeed, the Christ child is born and has his whole life and works still in front of him. Put memory away for tonight, the poem seems to be saying, because the whole world is about to change forever. Let's listen now to Put Memory Away, performed by Portland Choir and Orchestra at our Christmas concert in December 2019. Well, thanks, David, for joining me today.
It's been fun, Brad, to go over these songs. It's been more than fun. It's been meaningful because it's reminded me of what a privilege and opportunity it is to be associated with Portland Choir and Orchestra.
Great. And to our listeners, is there a song that has inspired you to be a better person, whether a Christmas song or not? If so, leave a comment below, and perhaps we'll perform it in one of our upcoming concerts. Our next episode continues on the theme of Christmas and is entitled Christmas Stories. We'll analyze and share several musical numbers we've performed over the years that combine music with narration, dance, and video to tell a meaningful story about Christmas. That episode will premiere on December 12th. Please join us for Christmas Stories next time on Backstage with Portland Choir and Orchestra.